We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his entire household, all his companions. We ask Allah to bless them and to bless every single one of us, beloved brothers and sisters in Islam. The prophecies of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam show that he was indeed a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will dive straight into the topic because it is a very, very important subject, and at the same time I will try and cover as much as I can so that we can all understand and realize several points. One is the truthfulness of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the fact that he was indeed sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and indeed he had given us information that we see has happened and that we have felt and we have lived in the midst of such news. Yet at that time they had not even imagined that there would come a time that this would happen if it was not for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whatever I say this evening is taken from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or from verses of the Quran. And inshallah I will give you the references at the end. If anyone would like to purchase the books or to read the books in the libraries, they may exist there. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. The signs of the hour are a means of strengthening our iman, a means of understanding that we have a gift, and that is the fact that we are followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The verses I read just now before you have a portion which states, إن الله عنده علم الساعة. Indeed, Allah is the one who has the knowledge of the hour. That is Allah. The hadith of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, reported by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, which is muttafaqun alayhi, agreed upon, found in Sahih Muslim, Sahih al-Bukhari, and many other books of hadith, where a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was very good looking, he was wearing white clothing, he had very black hair. Nobody knew him, but they could see that he was not looking like he had undertaken a journey. And he came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking him several questions. One of the questions was, when is the hour? He responded saying, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied saying, مَا الْمَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. The one who is being asked knows no more than the one who is asking, which means it is only Allah who knows when the hour shall be. So he asked another question, so what are the signs of the hour? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a few signs, inshallah we will be mentioning these as well as many more this evening. There are two types of signs of Qiyamah: those which are considered the major signs and those which are considered the minor signs. We will concentrate on the minor signs today, and I will very quickly make mention of the major signs at the end of my talk, inshallah. The reason is, we will notice one by one, almost every single one of these signs has come to pass. We are either living it, or it has already passed, or we understand it because it is almost there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. My brothers and sisters, we all ask, when is Mahdi going to come? We all ask, when is Isa alayhi salam, the Prophet Jesus, may peace be upon him, going to return to the earth? Yes, it's a question. But the reality is, whilst we learn the answer of that, do not lose focus that we may have died before any of the major signs will come. What did myself and yourselves prepare for the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Never ever be deceived by this world. Like the verses I read at the beginning, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ. Do not let this dunya, this worldly life, deceive you. And do not let the big deceiver, who is the devil, deceive you as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O people, be conscious of Allah, be conscious of your Maker, and fear the day when no father shall be able to help his own child, or vice versa. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us comfort on that day, and may He make us from those who can be saved from the fire of hell. One of the first signs of Qiyamah that are made mention of is the mere fact that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a final messenger. Why is this a sign of Qiyamah? Two things we learn from this. One is, not all the signs are bad news. Some of them are actually good news in themselves, but they have within them information or news that now the world is going to come to an end. If he is the final Nabi, we are fortunate that Allah sent to us someone to guide us. But at the same time, we need to realize there will be no Nabi after him, which means after him the world will come to an end. That is how it is considered a sign of Qiyamah. He says, "Bu'ithtu ana wa sa'aka hatain." I have been sent myself and the hour as close as these two fingers. And he pointed with the first and second fingers together. And this hadith is appearing in Sahih al-Bukhari, narrated by Sahal ibn Sa'ad radiallahu anhu. And we need to know that that means I am so close to the hour. After me is going to be the hour. Before me, they were other prophets. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our offspring also from amongst those who will be following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may He make us from amongst those who do not solely pay lip service to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we are followers, we are lovers, we follow Him, we consider Him a Nabi, and our lives are heading in a different direction altogether. May Allah protect us. Secondly, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks of fitan. Fitan meaning trials, tribulations, calamities, one after the other. There will be confusion on earth. That is a prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, "Badiru bil a'mali fitanan ka qita'i al-layl al-mudhlim, yusbihu ar-rajulu mu'minan wa yumsi kafira." Wa yumsi mu'minan wa yusbihu kafira. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, you need to overtake with your deeds the evil, the trials, the tribulations, the calamities that shall happen. They will be darker than the darkness of the night, the dark corners of the night, which means nobody will see right from left, nobody will understand what's going on, nobody will realize things. The only way to succeed at that time is to overtake these fitan, these calamities, these difficult times, this hostile environment by doing good deeds, al-a'mal. With good deeds, you will be able to overtake the fitan and the difficulties, the trials, tribulations of the age. Obviously, that is a hadith. The Prophet ﷺ says, a person will be a mu'min, a believer in the morning, and he'll do something or say something or reject a verse of the Quran and so on. By the evening, he will be a non-Muslim. And in the evening, a person will be a mu'min, and by the morning, they will be a non-mu'min, meaning a non-believer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from amongst those. Then he says, in a hadith which is reported in At-Tabarani by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once made a dua, powerful dua. He says, "Allahumma barik lana fi sa'ina wa muddina." Oh Allah, grant us barakah in our measurements. Sa' is a measurement, and a mudd is also a measurement. A sa' is slightly bigger than a mudd. A mudd is like a handful. So, oh Allah, give us barakah in our sustenance, in other words. And the next part of the dua, he says, "Wabarik lana fi shamina wa yamanina." And Ya Allah, grant us barakah in the northern part of this region and in the southern part of this region. So that is what we call Palestine, Palestine and so on, Sham, Lebanon, Syria, those countries. And towards the south you find Yemen, and the term is used, Yamanina. Grant us barakah in this region. And you know that Islam has spread in the entire region. So one of the companions said, "Wafi Iraqina," what about our Iraq, Ya Allah? Which means towards the east, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What about towards the east? Do you know what he said? Allahu Akbar. He says, "Inna biha qarnu shaytani wa tahayyuju al-fitan." Allahu Akbar. In Iraq, they are the horns of the devil, and it is a place where the fitan will commence. Look at this. What a prophecy. This is reported in Tabarani years ago. There will be fitan in Iraq. There will be difficulty, calamity. That started at the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and the others. And you and I know of the battles that took place in Kufa with the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his own daughter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. To this day, there is a lot of fitna there. What we learn from this is that it is a prophecy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam already told us that towards that region of the east, there will be great difficulty. There will be a lot of fitan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. Another prophecy, another sign of Qiyamah, istidhafatul mali وَمَنْعُ الصَّدَقَةِ There will be lots of wealth. People will become loaded. They will be so rich that nobody will take zakah. To the degree that when you go to people with your wealth and you tell them, this is zakah, we'd like you to take it, he'll say, no, I don't need this wealth. Allahu Akbar. So consider the fact that you are giving your zakah an honor. It is an act of worship that needs both parties, not just one. This is why we always say, treat the poor with a lot of respect. Had it not been for them, you would not be able to fulfill a pillar of Islam, no matter how wealthy you are. May Allah accept us and may He make us give to the right cause. This evening, inshallah, I am also pleading with you to give to the right cause. Wallahi, we have so many from amongst us who can give even a little bit. It is sometimes an insult to go around collecting donations for a good cause. Where are those who can go around and hunt for the good cause in order to give? There will come a time when there will not be a cause for you to give because they won't need your wealth. Then what is going to happen? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why if you read in the Quran, Surah Al-Zilzal, where earthquakes are made mention of, and by the way, there is also a sign of Qiyamah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, earthquakes will increase. Earthquakes will increase. And the tremors will increase on the globe. Catastrophe will increase on the globe. Mass death will increase on the globe. Today we see mass death. In one narration he says, people will be fighting each other, killing for no reason. لا يدري القاتل فيما قتل ولا المقتول فيما قتل. A person who is being killed won't know, why am I being killed? And a person killing won't know, why am I killing? Take a look at the armies that are prowling across the globe, across the entire globe, and they are going around bombarding, killing. They don't know why they are doing it. They just received an instruction, go and fire. And they are killing innocent people across the globe. Why are they being killed? They don't know. We've never said a word wrong. Nothing has happened. We don't even understand. That is a prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why we come to see that the weather patterns will also change according to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will have severe winters, severe summers. You will have lots of hurricanes, tornadoes. Look at what's going on as we are speaking in some countries of the world. May Allah protect us. You will have floods. You will have lots of rain, but no produce, no crop from that rain. You see, rain is such, the right amount will bring about the correct amount of crops. If you have too little, you have no crop. If you have too much, you also have no crop. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and may He not punish us with the rain. So much so that in another hadith he says, the Arabian Peninsula will become green and it will blossom again. Subhanallah. Today there are golf courses in the Middle East and there are gardens that are more plush than those that myself and yourselves have. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. These are prophecies of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he went to Tabuk, he told, it was Mu'adh ibn Jabal, if I'm not mistaken, radiallahu anhu, that, oh Mu'adh, if you are given age and you live long, you will see this entire place turning green where the well was. And subhanallah, to this day, in the middle of Tabuk, there is a huge green garden, and that's where the well was. Allahu Akbar. It's a prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you have the verses of the Quran, وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا, speaking of the end, right at the end, the earth will spit out all its weight. Everything that it is holding will be spat out. There is a hadith which explains that this will happen in stages. The gold of the earth will come to the surface. The silver of the earth and all the minerals and all the valuable stones and gems will come up to the earth. Wallahi, in my country, in Zimbabwe, a few years ago, there was a little tremor in Mozambique which caused mountains to split, and they found them full of diamonds. Until today, we have the largest deposits of industrial diamonds on the globe. Do you know that? And it only happened a few years ago. They are discovering more gold. Why? It's coming up to the top. Do you know why? Because Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. Allah has created for you, O man, everything that is on the earth and in the earth. So if the earth is coming to an end, everything that's inside is for us, it must come out to the top and we must make use of it. And so wealth will increase. So it's common logic and sense that there cannot remain something of value under the earth when it was written for someone who was going to live above the earth. And this is why it is being extracted as we speak. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us barakah and blessings in our wealth. I see, normally when I speak of this, some of the people are smiling. The poorer people come, they nudge me later and say, we're waiting for that day, man. We haven't yet seen a bar of gold. Allahu Akbar. Don't worry, it's coming. But when it comes, it will come with a lot of fitna. So better you have a smaller amount with much happiness than to have large amounts with great turmoil and turbulence, even in your own home. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us through the blessed lips of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when the calamities come, something major will occur to the ummah and to the globe. And it will seem like this is the worst thing that ever happened. And after that, something else will happen which will eclipse every time the previous occurrence. So something major happens and everyone says this is the worst ever. Something else will happen, they will still say it's the worst ever. They forget the previous one and it will be made to be eclipsed by the other one, the next one which comes that is bigger than it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Another sign of Qiyamah or of the last day, a sign of the nearing of the hour is there will be many people, according to a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, many people who will be claiming prophethood. You know, you have Mirza Ghulam Qadiani, the Ahmadis they call. Who do they follow? They follow a man who claims to be a prophet. Yet he, if you study his medical history, he was psychologically quite ill and quite sick. He was a psychiatric patient. May Allah protect us. And may Allah grant us understanding. We have a difficulty today where the mu'mineen, they are lacking in character and conduct. And the disbelievers are overtaking us in character and conduct. Yes, we have been taught that your character and conduct is what will drive you to paradise. Why are we failing? It's a sign of the hour. Where we are only Muslims by name. The hadith says, لا يبقى من الإسلام إلا اسمه. There will come a time when nothing will remain from Islam besides its name. So today we say, you Muslim, Muslim. But look at how you dressed. Look at what you're doing. Look at the halal and haram. Look at everything around you. Absolutely nothing Islamic about you, my mother, my sister, my father, my brother. What is it Islamic about you? وَلَا يَبْقَى مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ إِلَّا رَسْمُهُ. The hadith says, nothing will remain from the Quran except its writing. So people won't understand it. They won't teach it. They won't put it into practice and they won't learn it. Nothing happening. This is why we always stress, do not be fooled by those who tell you you're not allowed to read the meanings of the Quran. They are moving signs of Qiyamah. May Allah protect us. They are encouraging ignorance and they are making us fools. We have been placed on this earth to worship Allah alone. If you read the Quran and you understand it, nobody will be able to fool you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. And that does not make us people who belong to cults or sects. We are still Muslimin. Because we want to follow what Allah has made mention of. And we want to understand the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So many people will come. A narration makes mention of 30. Some say more than 30. Approximately 33. All those narrations are intertwined. People who claim, I'm a prophet. I've come with prophecies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Then there is a hadith which says, by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا ضُيِّعَتِ الْأَمَانَةُ فَانْتَظِرِ السَّاعَةِ. When trust has been lost, then wait for the hour. Which means, closer to the time, there'll be no more trustworthy people on the earth. Not at all. So, you look at people, they cheat you in business, they deceive you. You look at people, they rob you, they steal from you. You look at people, they appear so honest, yet they are not. They don't pay back their loans, enmity and so on, because of dishonesty. And then the Sahaba radiallahu anhum asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the meaning of daya'ul amana? Can you give us a deeper explanation? He gave a powerful explanation. He says, إِذَا وُسِّدَ الْأَمْرُ إِلَىٰ غَيْرِ أَهْلِهِ فَانْتَظِرِ السَّاعَةِ. When authority has been handed to a person who is not qualified for that position, then wait for the end of time. Two meanings to this. You have a company, you have a home, you have anything you have. You have a country, you have a masjid being run, you have a school being run. When the person at the top calling the shots is not even qualified for that position, then that item will be completely destroyed to start with. And on top of that, it will be a sign of the coming of the end of time. This is what it is. So you have a person who is the chairman of a masjid. He himself is not really bothered about Islamic rules and regulations. You have a person who is the chairman of a school. He has got even grade 2, grade 3 education. He has the last. You have a director of a football club. He cannot kick a ball to save his life. Allahu Akbar. I don't know what made me give that example. So this is why it is important to decline a position that you are not fit for. When you know that you are not qualified for it, give it to someone who is qualified. And when you are qualified and get to the post, you find ignorant people will try and pull the chair away from you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us steadfastness. And may He make it a means of our entry into Jannah. So this is also a sign of Qiyamah, to say people will lead countries and you ask them a question, they won't even know. Allahu Akbar. You see, today, if you take a look at the globe, the democracy of the world steers an ignorant person into the position of power because he is popular. Yet he doesn't know where Iraq is. Wallahi, I'm telling you. He doesn't know where Iraq is. And he leads the most powerful nation on the globe according to the masses. Allahu Akbar. It has happened. And look at the destruction that such a person causes, because they have no understanding. In order to remain in power, they need to try and remain as popular as possible. So they do whatever needs to be done, whether it is right or wrong. They cannot make decisions of their own. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُهُ بِمَوْتِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يَبْقَ عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤَسَاءَ جُهَّالًا فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. الله أكبر. What a powerful hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about how knowledge will be snatched away and ignorance will be spread. He says Allah will snatch knowledge away as a sign of the hour. Knowledge will go. The knowledgeable will be considered ignorant. Did you hear that? Someone has knowledge, he'll be considered ignorant. And the ignorant will be considered knowledgeable. Then the knowledgeable will begin to be taken away through means of death by Allah. So this is why we are taught, مَوْتُ الْعَالِمِ ثَلْمَةٌ لَا تُسَدُّ. The death of an active alim who is working very hard is a gap that will never be filled in the same way. You have one solid alim doing work. When he passes away, you will need 10 others who will take up the post of one man. When one of those 10 passes away, you need another 10 to do the work of one. And when one of those pass away, you need another 10 to do the work of the one who was doing the work of a tenth of what the previous one was doing, and so on. You understand the barakah? And you can see it in your own midst, where you have powerful ulama, when they pass away, you have a large group of people doing their work. But you don't have a single person who can actually do the same work. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills that to happen, there will be pockets of that. And one of the examples is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has hundreds of thousands of sunnah. He used to deal with every department on his own. What happened thereafter? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum all had to deal with different departments and so on. And now as time passes, we are unable to fulfill more than 10 or 15 sunnah in our lives. Yet there are 100,000 and more sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's because we are not messengers. We are not prophets. And we have come 1400 years down the line. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us barakah. Then the hadith says, time will crumple. You know what time crumpling means? A long time ago when I was young, the day used to start very early. And by midday already we would have achieved everything and our day was almost over in terms of achievement. Today, your week passes and you have not achieved what you were able to achieve 10 years ago in a day. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because there is no more barakah in time, no more blessing in time. Time crumpling also means that a year goes past like a month. A month goes past like a week. A week goes past like a day. And a day goes past like an hour. An hour goes by like a minute. And a minute like a second. Allahu Akbar. That is called the crumpling of time. Imagine, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied it. Wallahi, we are living it. Every Ramadan passes faster than the previous one. Do you know that? You're seeing the moon, before you know you're seeing the moon eat. Allahu Akbar. That is a sign of the end of time. That brings me to another major issue. The Prophet ﷺ has prophesied that one of the signs of the hour is the huge argument and debate about the moon. The issue of the moon will become so big that it will split people. They will argue and debate. Is this today's moon? Yesterday's moon? What moon is this? Today, don't you see the moon? Not only was it physically split, but it has split us three ways. That's why I always tell people, do you really know that unity is not achieved by having Eid on one day? That's not unity, that's physical togetherness. Unity is achieved when every heart realizes that I have rights over me that need to be fulfilled for the rest, for the others. all creatures have rights over me that need to be fulfilled. When you believe that and practice it, unity will be achieved within 1 second, automatically. The problem with us, we all become our own people. That's another sign of Qiyamah. The Prophet ﷺ says, As-salamu lil-ma'rifah. We greet people only whom we know. We will only greet people we know. Nowadays, we don't greet people. We greet a vehicle because it's nice. You know, the Mercedes, you look at it, you know. Why? Because, hey, that's a vehicle. The guy inside, you know, he will never throw 50 rands out of the window. Relax. Allahu Akbar. It's impossible for that to happen. Greet, تسلم على كل من عرفت ومن لم تعرف. Can I teach you something? Take your time to greet those who are slightly less privileged. Smile at them. Ask them one or two more questions. Not panchat, as we call it. Hey, you know what? Tell me something. What happened in your personal life, man? Come on, we're hearing about... What are you talking about? Allahu Akbar. How are you, my brother? How is things? MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. And so on. These type of questions are good. The minute you start getting into personal issues, they won't want to greet you. Today, one of the difficulties is we abuse the fact that we know each other. Brother, lend me some money. Come on. Then we don't want to greet him. Because if I greet him, he's going to ask me a favor. Someone walks into the shop, we run behind. Why? I don't want this guy to ask for a discount. That's why the best thing, do not ask unnecessarily for discounts and so on. And do not burden one another with things because you pay full price. When he comes to your place, he will pay full price. At least you love one another. Wallahi, you have not lost any love. Remember, for 1 rand and 2 rands discount, we stop greeting each other. For a small problem on inheritance and the problem of a little issue in the home, we stop talking to brothers and sisters for 20 years. That is a sign of the hour. Remember, we are moving signs of the hour. If you have not spoken to family members for so many years, you are a sign of the end of times. A moving sign. Allahu Akbar. So resolve your matters and solve them. And this is why we say, do not just greet people because you know them. Greet those whom you don't know as well. Do not greet people because of their wealth. Greet them even if they are underprivileged. Take your time to greet even children. The Prophet ﷺ, a sunnah of his, was he spent a few moments more with children. They are the champions of tomorrow. Do you know the amount of confidence building that happens when you as an adult spends a moment of importance with a child? Greet him. How are you? Oh, mashallah. Excellent. You did well. Even if the child did not perform so well, you greet him, you congratulate him. It builds his confidence. Today we look at the children of others and we tend to put them down. So others look at our children and put them down. So tomorrow the leaders, they all have an inferiority complex, each one fighting the other. May Allah protect us. Signs of the hour. Then the Prophet ﷺ speaks of something else. يُشِكُ أَن تَدْخُلَ مَسْجِدَ جَمَاعَةٍ فَلَا تَرَى فِيهِ رَجُلًا خَاشِعًا. Soon a time will come when you will enter a masjid. Jama'ah. People will be reading salah with jama'ah. Not one person will be concentrating in salah. Not one. So the concentration in prayer and in salah will be taken away. Why? Because people will have too many unnecessary things in their minds. Today we are filled with movies. We are filled with computer games. We are filled with this and that. Unnecessary things. Discussions of gossip. Gossip meaning absolute nothings. You know, sister will talk for 1 hour on telecom. And now you have Viber. And now you have no-no. And you have the VoIP. And all other things. Tango. So what happens? We're tangoing. Doing what? Talking about her and that one, this one. Hey, listen, I need to read my salah. These are good people. They're talking about their salah. But look, the phone goes down, the salah is darted like a chicken, and we're back on it. Hey, where did we leave off? Yeah, yes, we were talking. Oh yeah, I remember now what you were saying. Allahu Akbar. This is a person who remembered to read their salah. In salah, they're thinking of the juicy stories, and they're even doing this. And we're wondering what's going on. Wallahi, sometimes you enter a masjid. I did it too. I watched a few uncles, and you know what? You wonder what's going on. Allahu Akbar. At least nobody here is my uncle. Allahu Akbar. So brothers and sisters, try your best to concentrate in salah by eradicating that which is unnecessary. Imagine if that which is unnecessary causes lack of concentration in salah. What do you think sin will do? Sin will remove your entire sweetness of salah. You won't even want to read the salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, grant us ease and goodness. Then there is another narration. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Yushiku." أَنْتَدَاعَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأُمَمُ كَمَا تَدَاعَ الْأَكَلَةُ عَلَىٰ قَصْعَتِهَا. Very soon, all the nations will encircle you and they will come to attack you together, just like a pack of wolves come around a chunk of meat and they start ripping and tearing from it. So the nations will come and try and rip the Muslimin. We're witnessing it today. If you're a Muslim, by name also, you won't be allowed entry into some countries just because you have a name and an identity. That's it. What is your crime? Nothing. We probably have benefited humanity much more than the whole city put together. But they will say, no, you're not allowed. Why? Because you're a Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ, he has prophesied this as a sign of the hour. Do you know what he says? Al-qabidu ala dinihi kal-qabidu ala jamr. A person who wants to hold fast to their religion will be similar to someone who is holding a red hot coal. Today in your own home you want to wear hijab, your father tells you, you know what, you're too young. Allahu Akbar, may Allah safeguard us. Your own father is a sign of Qiyamah. Why? He's making it hard for you to read Salah. Dad, we're traveling on a journey. Please, let's stop. Here is Harry Smith. We can read our Salah. There is a beautiful Musalla. No, man, come on, man. What do you think? You know what? Few kilometers later, huge motor vehicle accident. The father died, but the daughter who said that remained alive. Do you see this? What was his last statement? No, man, it's okay. Just leave it. Never mind. We still, it's all right, man, you know. No even excuse. This is what happens. So people holding on to their deen will be so difficult today to look as a Muslim. It's become tough, hard, because to wear a scarf, your own people start giving you dirty looks. You want to grow a beard, your wife wants to leave you. That is a sign of Qiyamah. It's a sign of Qiyamah. We need to understand and realize the pleasure of Allah comes first. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. You don't want to attend a mixed gathering, your own people tell you this guy is, you know, he's a hardliner, he's like this, he's like that. You don't want to, for example, go to a function of haram, they tell you this guy is a hardliner. Sign of Qiyamah. May Allah protect us, may He grant us morality, may He grant us good character and conduct, and may He make us from those who can live the most upright we can in this very, very hostile environment. When we say hostile environment, you look left, you see haram. You look right, you see haram. You look that direction, you see haram. You look everywhere, you see haram. We need to, inshallah, try our best to hold onto the deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Then there is a narration. In fact, let me finish the narration I started about how the nations will come around the Muslimin. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why will that happen? أَمِنْ قِلَّةٍ نَحْنُ يَوْمَ إِذٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Is it because we will be small in number, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they will trample all over us and try to oppress us and they will start fighting us? He says, no, إِنَّكُمْ يَوْمَ إِذٍ كَثِيرٌ. On that day you will be large in numbers. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءِ السَّيْلِ. But you will be like the froth of a flood. You know that right at the top you have all this white. I can explain it to you with the example of Coke. You know when you pour Coke into a glass, you find the froth goes right to the top. But when it settles, how much Coke is there? Nothing. We could use that with the little children before. Yeah, I filled your glass. There's nothing inside there. When it settles, hey, there's nothing in here. So what will happen? You big in number, but the real mu'mineen are very small in number. You see? Everyone else is like the froth. When the cracks come, when the crunch comes, everyone is gone. There's only a little band of people remaining. So the Prophet ﷺ says, you will be large just like that. يُصِيبُكُمُ الْوَهْنُ. And something called wahn will overtake you. What is wahn? He says, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. The love of this world and the hatred of death, detesting death. We will not die under any circumstances. Wallahi, death is in the hands of Allah. He can take you at any time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us in a condition that He is pleased with us. It is not good. It is not good enough to think that I am healthy, let me sin, let me go here. Life is not about sinning. Aren't you fed up of sinning? Life is not about everything here and there. No. Life is not about fulfilling all your desires in a haram way. No. Life is about discipline and the pleasure of Allah. Can you build your akhirah? If you can, you are successful. Look, anything you want in this world, you need to work hard to achieve it. So what about that which you want to get in the akhirah? You need to work even harder to achieve it. Subhanallah. You want a large building. You want a school. You want something for your children. You need to work morning to evening. You will get something. So why don't we work morning to evening for Allah so that we get something in the akhirah? And we do not go against the rules of our bosses at work, otherwise they will fire us. Why then do we go against the rules of Allah, who is the ultimate boss? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Another prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there will be lots of policemen, many gendarmes, you know, policemen, military men, too many of them. And there will be many people to help those who are oppressing and not those who are oppressed. So you find an oppressor oppressing, he'll have a lot of support. But you find the one who is oppressed, nobody will even come to help him. It's happening on an individual basis, on a community basis, as well as national basis, international basis across the globe. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. All policing, you see, it's become a police state. Do you know why? Nobody's honest anymore. Police state to the degree that the police themselves are not honest. Hamiha, haramiha. The people who are supposed to protect you are the actual criminals. That's also something that we need to think about. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. Another sign of Qiyamah. People will not want to know one another. Even brothers, they won't want to know one another. Something bad happening to you there, the people will walk away and then let you deal with your own crisis on your own. You are your own man. When something bad happens to them, you walk away. You know what is the minus point regarding this? What is the loss? When you destroy a person individually, it's very easy to bring him down. But wait, when 20 people come together, you cannot bring them down as easily. This is why when we are united as an ummah, to bring us down is almost impossible. But the minute we are split into groups, the enemy does not need to do any more work. Each group is fighting each other. This is what happens. Start fighting one another. That is also a sign of Qiyamah, where our own ummah will be engaged in shirk. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. People who claim to be my followers will actually be mushriks. They will actually be people who worship everything and anything besides Allah, together with Allah, and they will not even think for a moment that what we are doing is wrong. And they will call themselves my ummah. That is a sign of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why we say, the most valuable gift you ever have is the fact that Allah has protected you from shirk. Why do we say that is the most valuable gift? That is what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. And that is the thing that will save you from Jahannam. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَٰلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. Allah will not forgive shirk. He tells you, you want to associate partners with me in worship? I'm not going to forgive that. If you die without repenting, I'm not going to forgive that. And besides that, if you die without repentance with any other sins, if I want, I can forgive anything. And I can even grant you paradise through my mercy, no matter what. So this is one major point that is an obstacle between us and entry into paradise. We need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says thereafter, adultery will increase and the number of women will be multiplied to the degree that they will be 50 times more than men. Adultery will increase. Why? 50 women will be fighting for one man. One man fighting. You know why? Many reasons. One is shortage of men. Secondly, shortage of good men. It's a problem. Because why? Sometimes, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. And I say this because it's a fact. To marry a married man is better than to marry a single man who is a drug addict. Believe me. This is why the doors of polygamy need to be opened and opened very wide. Remember, my sisters, it might be a bitter pill to digest unless you or your sister or family member is affected. It is coming, it will come. But the brothers, the difficulty we have, we do it in the wrong way. And that is why our sisters are not prepared to accept it. Not because Allah decreed and not because it is this and that. No, the way we choose to do it is absolutely unacceptable in 99% of the cases. So it is something balanced. We cannot blame one another. But at the same time, we need to go back and see where we're going wrong. And we need to realize there are hundreds of thousands of women who do not have spouses for one of two reasons. Either there are no men, or either the men available are not good enough. They're not marriage material. My sister, I promise you, you'd rather be single than to be married to a man who's going to make your life a mess. Believe me, it's a bigger gift to remain single and inshallah to get into the akhirah, to choose whom you want, than to be here in the dunya, married to someone who has made your life such a mess that you have become a patient on medication of a psychiatric nature. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our brothers and sisters, and may He grant us happiness in our marriage. That brings us to another sign of the hour. Lots of divorce. Do we not see? Today, when people get married, it's no longer, hey, they've been living for so long. It's how quickly the divorce took place. Allahu Akbar. One man, true story, got married. Boy got married to his love for the last 8 years. On the table, as they were having this walima of theirs, he says, pass me the salad. She says, who the hell do you think you are? You think you're going to give me instructions to give you things like this when we're married? Talak, talak, talak. Like a little chicken sounding. Have you heard the sound? Tak, tak, tak. Sounds the same, isn't it? May Allah protect us. A'udhu billah. Wallahi. And this is a function where people came to celebrate the getting together of them. They were separated in this country. May Allah protect us. May Allah grant us ease and goodness. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, we don't know why we get married. That's the problem. Why do you marry? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and understanding. You want a good man. My sisters, are you worth being in his family? That's a question you need to ask. We all want good spouses, don't we? Well, are you good yourself to fit that position? Perhaps you might enter there and you might be a very big means of destruction. So that is why work on your own character. Be a person who is ready to sacrifice. Without sacrifice, a marriage doesn't work. And divorce is a sign of the hour. May Allah protect us. People have taken it lightly. The smallest things, we divorce. Never ever utter those words. Otherwise, we become statistics. Then there is another sign of the hour. We mentioned how adultery will increase, but shamelessness will also increase. People will be committing adultery on the streets. So much so that the hadith says the best man at the time will be the one who has the guts to say, listen, please can you go and commit this, whatever you're doing, behind the wall at least, not on the road. So he's not saying don't do it. He's telling them where to do it, because he's a little bit shameful. That's all. This is a sign of the hour. And this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ specifically mentions exactly, لَوْ وَرَيْتَهَا وَرَاءَ الْحَائِطِ. Why don't you go back behind the wall to do it instead of here in public? May Allah protect us. Wallahi, people are becoming shameless. Very, very shameless. Then there is a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ speaks of, لَا يُبَالِ الْمَرْءُ أَمِنَ الْحَلَالِ أَكَلَ أَمْ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ. A person will not be bothered whether they are eating from haram or halal. I'm not even bothered. So riba and interest will be eaten by everyone. And those who don't eat it, they will get the scent of it. They will be forced to deal in one way or another in such a way that they have smelt it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. We've arrived at that age. Sign of the hour. People are not bothered whether they eat halal or haram. I want to share with you something interesting. You know, the Hindus, hats off for one thing, they will not consume, I'm talking of the serious Hindus, they will not consume meat products until death to please their Bhagwan. Do you agree with me? With us, nobody's asking you to become a vegetarian. When you are doubtful, still we don't want to leave it. We say, no, don't worry, man, this is okay, just chow, man. You heard that? It's lack of chows. I've heard that here. I learned that statement here in this country. Lack of chows. MashaAllah. Wallahi, to be honest with you, they can stay away from meat products their whole lives. We can't even stay away from it under certain circumstances. Allahu Akbar. Have you ever thought of the dedication? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us even better than that. We are Muslimin. We are supposed to be ready to surrender to the law of Allah. Then you have another sign of Qiyamah. The Prophet ﷺ says a time will come, يَسْتَحِلُّونَ الْحِرَى. People will consider zina and adultery halal. They'll give it a different name and they'll consider it permissible. وَالْحَرِيرَ. Harir means silk. And the term silk for men, silk is here referring to feminine clothing for males, will become something that everybody will consider okay. Have you seen the skinny jeans and all these shirts? Wallahi, more worse than feminine. Today I spoke at Jumu'ah and I said, do you know this business of covering yourself properly? We always blast the women. Wallahi, the same ruling applies to the men. Did you ever know that? When we say same ruling, we're talking of the awrah might be slightly different. Yes, for a man, what is considered private part is slightly different, but the clothing needs to be made of a certain of material and loosely fitting. Did you ever know that? That's also for a man. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Today you have skinny jeans. That's absolutely unacceptable. It's equivalent to a miniskirt of a female. Did you know that? Today you have tight shirts with your buttons open and you want to expose. That is equivalent to perhaps something else that the females are doing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. The men folk, especially the youth, do not be conned by the television and the media into wearing items that are totally un-Islamic. They chase away the angels of mercy and protection that have been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for myself and yourselves. So this is why we say, clothing of women worn by men. Clothing of men worn by women. What will happen? An increase in homosexual behavior. A'udhu billah. Look at this. We see it happening in front of us. An increase in homosexual behavior. A woman is so exposed that there's no big deal. A man is so covered that when he shows his foot, another man is looking at him. Have you thought of that? That's exactly what's happening on the globe. A woman is so exposed that when you look at her, it's no big deal, you don't get aroused. And a man is so well covered that when another man sees his calf, he says, "Ooh, Allahu Akbar, Allah safeguard us." That is how homosexuality spreads. This is why we say, women, when you cover from top to bottom, the day you expose your calf to your husband, wallahi, if he's a good believer who lowers his gaze, he will appreciate every millimeter of it. Allahu Akbar. Today, nothing is appreciated. Why? Because you just go to the mall and what you see is far better than anything you have. You're not going to get that. Never ever. Your eyes can be filled with everything. You're never going to get it. You'll die depressed, but you're not going to get that. Allahu Akbar. So rather make use of what you have and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a sign of Qiyamah, a sign of the hour. So this is why we need to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. You know, when it comes to clothing, remember there is a reason why Allah has set aside different clothing and different positions, different roles for people to fulfill so that they are attracted to one another in the correct sense and they can fulfill, you know, we used to have a time when people say, you know, I want to get married to so-and-so, my father is saying no. So now as ulama, you've got to go and talk and see what's going on and so on. And then you have we came across another stage where people say, you know, I want to get married to so-and-so, they're not Muslim, but they're ready to revert. So you've got to talk to the father again, and you've got to tell them this and this. You know what we tell them these days? Uncle, thank Allah that your son wants to marry a woman. Allahu Akbar. There are others who want to marry men, you know. Uncle says, no, can't be. Then you start showing him. You see that uncle there? I was on a flight one day. I met a man and I greeted him and so on. I was coming from Cape Town. And he told me, I said, what's your name? He says, Sulaiman. I said, oh, mashallah, this, that, what. And we got talking and he started speaking about things. I told him, oh, so how many children do you have? He looked about 60. It's a true story. And he told me, this is my partner. I said, who? He said, the Hussein next to me. Sulaiman married Hussein. He said, the Imam did the nikah. Allahu Akbar. I asked him one question, and I'm going to tell it to you because we're living in an age where we need to know. I said, look, I don't mean to be bad. I'm about to change my seat because I'm feeling a bit nauseous. He says, you know what? We can actually get you locked up. I said, what for what? He said, because you're discriminating. I said, what are you talking about? You can't do that. I'm feeling nauseous. It's natural. I can't afford. I said, okay, anyway, I want to ask you one question. What do you do? He told me, stop intimidating. Stop. I don't know, a few words. I just got up and I just carried on. Allahu Akbar. And they have no answer. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is a sign of the hour. And wallahi, it is something to cry about because our children are exposed to it to the degree that in some countries it is prohibited to actually look down upon that. And in some countries, the school syllabus has in it that you need to teach the children that these people are absolutely normal. And if you have this type of inclination, there is no harm and no problem. This is what is being taught forcefully to the children of the Muslims across the globe in certain countries. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. May we never see such days in our places. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. It's a sign of Qiyamah, a sign of the end of time, prophesied by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he says, wal ma'azifa. Ma'azif meaning musical instruments will be considered permissible. Did you hear this? Well, Ma'azif, this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. Why would that be the case if musical instruments were permissible? I always tell people to know music is haram. You don't need the Quran, you don't need the Sunnah. You just need to study the lives of the top musical people in the world. Study their lives. 99.9% of them are totally depressed, upside down on medication. Their lives are in a mess. Half of them are divorced more than 10 times and so on. And they have no life at all. And they worship the devil and Satan. Their dress code is up the pole. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. You don't need anything. You look at how dirty they are. The lyrics are as filthy as ever. People say, no, what if it's light, soothing, classical music? How can you replace the Quran with something of that nature? Does the Quran not soothe you? If the Quran does not soothe you, remember, nothing ever will soothe you. My brothers and sisters, is this not a time? If Ibrahim alayhi salam became a friend of Allah when he was prepared to sacrifice his own child, can we not become friends of Allah by sacrificing even the music discs we have, throwing them out of our motor vehicles? We might die in a condition where, had we not thrown those CDs out, perhaps we may have had music blasting with Beyonce and Rihanna whilst we died. It can happen. I'd rather have the Quran play. Wallahi, you never know when you're going to die. I have been at a scene of an accident where the car was a write-off, but the music was blasting. Four youngsters were crushed to death. I don't know how that music was still playing, yet the car was written off totally. And I was at the site of that particular accident. And we started weeping and crying. Why? Because I said to myself, if only the ummah could see this, wallahi, they would realize and understand. Substitute all this with the Quran. How blessed would the entire scene have been, and how changed it would have been if the same scenario had Quran playing. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make us strong. Today we cannot sacrifice one CD of a naked person on the globe, and we talk about Qurbani and Eid al-Adha and Udhiya and sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. We don't even deserve a droplet of that. Why? We're not ready to sacrifice anything for the pleasure of Allah. Nothing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. Another sign of the hour. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, alcohol and intoxicants will be given different names and they will be considered permissible. Take a look today, people ask you about weed. Weed. You know, I have a friend of mine from Canada, and giving a lecture, he says, in his Canadian accent, he says, the only weed and beer that we Muslims know is tajweed and tak beer. That's very, very true, to be honest with you. The weed is considered like something that is air. People are breathing it. When the World Cup was going on here, one man tells me that I went to watch a football match, and every Muslim I saw in one of the stadiums, he was like with this weed, and even she, which means the women as well. And they're looking at me like I am somebody who is really from outer space, because I am not engaging in it. What are you talking about? The smell of it. Never mind that. People are on a high throughout their lives without knowing. Do you know that? People are intoxicated sometimes throughout their lives without even knowing, because they are on it. And then they want to justify it. You know, this marijuana and marijuana, whatever they call it, is now legalized in certain states in the United States. Wallahi, Islam is not subservient to what is decided in the US. No. Islam is Islam. This is Allah and His Rasul. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Another sign of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. أن يتباهى الناس في المساجد. People will be competing with one another in beautifying masjids and building masajid. So the masjid, masajiduhum عامرة وهي خراب من الهدى. The masajid will be built, well built, beautiful, beautified, lots of money spent. So many masajid, no guidance in it. There'll be no guidance. You go in there, you actually get fitna and you come out. علماؤهم شر من تحت أديم السماء تبدأ الفتنة منهم وفيهم تعود. There will come a time when the biggest fitna will be started off by so-called ulama. They start the fitna. And the fitna will attack them, engulf them, and overtake them. This is why we say, my brothers and sisters, we need to make some time to attend the Islamic programs that the masajid have. So at least we will not be a statistic and a moving sign of Qiyamah. In our masajid, we want guidance. We want to go there to achieve peace, not to achieve war. Today you go to a masjid, you come out having been, you know, you feel so bad. I met this one, I met that one. Better I don't go to the masjid. Why? Because people have robbed you, stolen from you, sworn you and so on. And you find them in the first saf so hypocritically. May Allah protect us. May He grant us goodness. Another sign of the hour is that the Bedouin Arabs will be competing with one another in the height of the buildings they build. I will stop there. It says a lot. You find it in Dubai, you find it in Mecca and Medina, you find it all over the show. It's a sign of Qiyamah, it's a sign of the hour. One man built it 1.3 kilometers, the other one says, I'm waiting for him to finish so I know how tall to build mine. This is a true story, wallahi. So now they want to put up one somewhere else. And you know what? You can go right up to wherever you want to go. Believe me, it's not going to help you in any way if you do not have piety and taqwa. It's the taqwa that will actually help. May Allah grant that to us. Then there is another sign of the hour. A woman will give birth to her boss. A woman giving birth to her boss means many things. You know, one might say, okay, a slave girl giving birth to someone who is going to be a boss. One can even say that today the mothers, their children control them and decide. That's also correct. There is another meaning to it. You know, you have surrogate mothers where a woman doesn't want stretch marks on her belly. So she is too lazy to put tissue oil from the day she falls pregnant right to the end. And her husband is too lazy to actually take part in that activity. So what happens? They decide there is a womb for rent in Philippines. And they are charging $95 for 9 months. So what we do, we get the fusion of the eggs, and once you have this little zygote, we will implant it into the womb of a certain lady in Philippines, and we pay her. When you pay her, who does she give birth to? Her boss. Allahu Akbar. Someone whom she was paid for carrying, not hers, not at all. It's happening today on the globe. There are so many families. If you go onto Google and you try and look for these women, you'll find plenty of them because they have a womb, and these other women don't want stretch marks. This is why I tell them, men, wife has stretch marks, you are the guilty one. Go and kiss them and say, this is jihad fi sabilillah. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi. A man wants to turn away from his wife after she's given birth to 3 children because her belly is now no longer as flat as it used to be. Who is the guilty one? If you didn't really want that, why did you have children? Allahu Akbar. How can we then reduce the value of our women? Their value should increase the more they've given birth. تَزَوَّجُوا الْوَدُودَ الْوَلُودَ فَإِنِّي مُبَاهِمْ بِكُمُ الْأُمَمَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ The Prophet ﷺ says, I want you to marry the women who are loving and childbearing because I would like to be the ummah that has the largest members from amongst all the other prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Then we have another sign of Qiyamah. Two things that I'm going to talk about. If you know, you will understand. One is the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum say, two types of people we haven't yet seen that the Prophet ﷺ described. One is nisa'un, women. Kasiyatun, ariyatun, ma'ilatun, mumilatun, ru'usuhunna ka'asnimatil bukhtil ma'ilah. The Prophet ﷺ says, women who will be clothed in order to expose. They will cover in order to display. So they will be covered but uncovered. This is tight clothing, sign of Qiyamah. The minute you're wearing the tights and the top, you know this is a moving sign of Qiyamah. The Prophet ﷺ prophesies that there will be women who will be wearing tight-fitting clothing or see-through clothing that will be totally revealing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us moving signs of the hour. Imagine the curse of a person who does that. My mothers and sisters, it's not worth it. If you want to do that, make sure it is in the presence of your maharim, and then you must don with your cloak that is loose fitting if you come out. And it's better to get your cupboard rid of all those things. May Allah protect our men folk are also guilty of saying, no, that's what I want. That's what I like. And you know, women sometimes are lost because the men, they're like, they've never seen a woman before, the way they're looking. And the wife is trying to look, what is he looking at? And when she sees, she wants to be like that. But when she bees like that, she becomes a sign of Qiyamah. You see what I'm saying? So this is why it's a massive cauldron full of hot oil. Everything is dissolving inside it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness. So a sign of Qiyamah, women, they will be turning heads and making heads turn. That's the word that's used. Today in English language also they say, hey, she makes all the heads turn. All the heads are turning. Wallahi, turn the heads. Allahu Akbar. Head turning. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. their heads will be like the humps of a camel. Now, the humps of a camel, obviously, this is a hairstyle. If you take a look at the internet, you will find many people saying that, oh, it's a little clip at the back of the head. If your clip is at the top of the head, maybe it might be a camel hump. If it's at the back of the head, the ulama say, perhaps, it may be, we don't know, depending on its size and why it's there. If you have someone who's got two heads, it's definitely a sign of Qiyamah. You know, you have your head and a clip the size of your head on top of that. That's like, perhaps it would be in that hadith. But this hadith is more speaking about the head. Ru'usuhunna. Their heads will be like that. Which means part of the head, the hairstyle comes. And we've seen it. If you take a look at some of the hairstyles, wallahi, you will see a woman with hair that is absolutely pathetic. But they consider it the in thing. Allah protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant our sisters the ability to don the hijab. My sisters, if you have a clip, if it's a small size, medium size, alhamdulillah. If it is there to hold your scarf, alhamdulillah. Don't put it at the top of your head. Put it at the back. And don't let it be too big that it juts out like it looks like another backside at the top of your head. Allah protect us. Yes, we need to understand and realize. If the hadith says something, let's try not to be from amongst those who are described here. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about people who will have whips, whipping each other. Whips like the tails of the ox. The ulama have spoken a lot. The most interesting explanation I came across is by an alim of today's age who says there is some sexual misbehavior called BDSM. If you've come across it, they tie the partner or the spouse and they wear leather and they have these whips, they whip each other and so on, prophesied by the Prophet ﷺ as a sign of Qiyamah. If you don't know about it, thank Allah. If you know about it, you still need to thank Allah that is a sign of Qiyamah and you've heard about it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and grant us safety, and may He grant us all goodness. Remember, when we are intimate with our spouses, it's an act of worship. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us be human and be sane, and may He protect us from animal behavior and that which is unacceptable in the Sharia. Then another sign of Qiyamah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about, I've already said, lots of death, mass death, and sudden death. A person is healthy, next thing he's gone. What happened? Sudden death. So much of it that it's shocking. It's a sign of the hour. It is happening now. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the marketplaces will come near, very, very near to one another. So much so, they will enter the home. Today you want to buy anything. What do you have? It's called bid or buy in this country. In other countries, it's called eBay. You just log on the net and it's delivered home. How do you pay? Swipe a card. Allahu Akbar. That is prophesied. There is another hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesizes the fitna of the satellite dish. Do you know how? He says, a time will come when the fitna will be beaming from the skies. These are the words used by him. Subhanallah. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum memorized the words and passed them. Today we see it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us savior. The fitna is being beamed from the satellite stations in the skies. Did you ever know that? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum did not understand exactly what that meant. They narrated it to us. We can see. What are people using satellite dishes for? They're using it for fitna and haram. In most cases, what is the internet for? Where is it based? What is happening? People are using it for haram. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who can use it for halal. And may Allah make us from those who can benefit from it so that it can be a means of our hidayah and guidance rather than a means of destruction. Take a look at this issue of nakedness that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about as a sign of the hour. There will be nakedness. You know, nakedness includes pornography. And take a look at the statistics of pornography on the globe. The Muslim countries have the largest subscribers to pornography on the globe. Have you known that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. It reduces the respect of the opposite sex in your eyes. It reduces the sweetness of your own halal intimacy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about people not wanting to know their own relatives. I want qati'atul rahim, which means you cut relations with your own brothers and sisters. We touched on it earlier, but it is a sign of the hour. And the neighbor will be the worst person, whereas a neighbor is supposed to be the best person. Then you have another sign of the hour. The old will begin to look young. Wallahi, that hadith, today I looked at it and I thought to myself, look, for your information, if I'm looking young, I've just clocked 35, 37, so just relax. May Allah grant us goodness and ease. You know, people say, hey, you know what, this guy must be about 50, 60. Wallahi, take it easy. No, don't blame us for things we haven't done. If you take a look, if you take a look at today, you have the creases of the face that can actually be reduced and taken out. So you find a man 70 years old, he comes back to you the next day, and he looks like a 12-year-old, 15-year-old, or perhaps 30-year-old. This is prescribed, or should I say, prophesized in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says that there will be a time that will come when the old people will begin to look young because of what they do. They will do something that makes them look young. You take a look. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. I don't want to dwell too much on it. Then there is another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, a time will come when a man will be honored and respected only because the people honoring him and respecting him are fearing the backlash if they don't do that. They worried about the harm this man can cause. They know he's evil, but they smile at him. Hey, how are you? What's happening? Hey, this guy is the man. He's the boss. He's the this. He's the that. And they respect him so much, they hate his guts. The only reason they're respecting him is because they are fearing, if I don't do this, he can harm me. Wallahi, it's happening in society today. Another sign of Qiyamah. There will be lots of business. And assert, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a group of people will control the business on the globe. Subhanallah. We can cry when we read this prophecy. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a hadith mentioned in Sunan al-Nasa'i by Amr ibn Taghlib radiallahu anhu. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the pious people will disappear. And then he begins to say, or he says, those who are the worst of society will be the leaders of the society. Those who are the scum will be considered the top brass. Those who have nothing will be considered heroes. Today a man can kick a ball and he is the biggest, most popular person on the globe. Why? Because he can kick a ball. He doesn't know anything. May Allah protect us. Another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, there will be many people, literacy will increase. So there are two narrations. One says literacy will increase, everybody will be able to read and write. Then there will come a time when people will not be able to write. Listen to this prophecy. Because everybody will be able to write and read, then they will be overtaken by a computer or by whatever typing. So now they can't write anymore. It's happening today already. People talk to a device. The people are typing, but you tell them to write. You cannot read anything because they don't know how to write. A time will come when writing will be insignificant because you won't need it. So this is a prophecy on the dot by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, people will be able to read and write, then they will be able to only read without writing. Allahu Akbar. Take a look at this. Then he says, people will be literate, but they will be ignorant. Which means what they have is not knowledge. It will be ignorance. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about how lies will be spread so much so that lies will be considered true and the truth will be considered lies. The people who are honest will be considered dishonest and the dishonest will be considered honest. Until a time comes when there will be so many difficulties, when a man passes a grave, he will hope that he was the one who died because of the amount of trouble and problems that the world will have at the time. So much so, the hadith says, if death was being sold, people would want to buy it. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. Then he speaks about some of the wars that will take place. Some of them have already taken place. There will be a war with the Romans, a war with the Jewish people, between the Muslims and the Jews and so on. It is being spoken about in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about how his own ummah will follow the trends of the Christians and the Jews. He says it clearly. لَتَتَّبِعُنَّ سَنَنَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ شِبْرًا بِشِبْرٍ وَذِرَاعًا بِذِرَاعٍ حَتَّى وَلَوْ سَلَكُوا بِكُمْ جُحْرَ ضَبِّ لَسَلَكْتُمُوهُ. You will begin to follow the trends of the people of the book before you. Even if they were to run into a hole of a reptile, you would run straight into that hole with them. Today, take a look at the way we talk, the way we walk, whatever we like and dislike, the way we dress, the way we want to be educated, the way we want to be known. Everything happens to follow the trends of the West. The trends of the kuffar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to believe or to understand and realize that we can take whatever is good, but whatever contradicts Islam, we're supposed to leave it at bay. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. A few more points inshallah. I know I have overshot slightly, but by the will of Allah, I've actually written these points down, so I think I should share all of them with you so we can have one solid talk where we can go home and start thinking about how fortunate we are to have all these prophecies, and at the same time learn a lesson for ourselves that we should not be moving signs of Qiyamah. The hadith says, Al-Amana, which means when a person entrusts someone with something, that person will consider it his own property and he won't give it back. So you go to someone, listen, my 5,000 rands, I'm going, I just need you to keep it. When you come back, you say, what 5,000 rands? I used it. Allahu Akbar. It's gone, it's mine. It's a hadith. Then you know Qiyamah is near. Then there will come a time when people will be very stingy, even though they will be very rich. So much so, we spoke to you about how people will not accept zakat, but people will not want to give zakat even though they are so rich. I think sometimes we have got to that stage where today, in order to raise funds for a powerful cause, we have to have a fundraising dinner. Allahu Akbar. Fundraising dinner. I still believe it's an insult upon the community and the wealthy of the community to have to stoop so low as to tell people, you know what, come, you pay for a plate of food, we're going to raise money for some orphans. Wallahi, where are the Muslims to look after those orphans? Who wants to build their Jannah? Come and donate a million. I was in a community a few weeks ago and I said, Subhanallah, the money that the rich or even the poor of the community that they have spent in the casino last month alone, come and put an equivalent amount here. We will never ever need funds again for the deen. Do you know that? Every month, put aside what you used in the casino last month. The people who are going there, go and take stock of the Muslims that are there. Whatever amount they've blown there, come and give it to the deen. See what happens. Allahu Akbar. I know of people who have lost 90 million in a casino one shot. They were not prepared to give 90 rands to an orphan. May Allah safeguard us. This is a red button. Like I always tell people, you know, our bread is not buttered by anybody here, so we can say the facts. May Allah protect us. May He grant us goodness. The Prophet ﷺ speaks also about how people's houses will be as though they're going to live forever. So they will be beautified with the latest technology, the latest everything. But my brother, my sister, your abode is the grave. Your abode is the akhirah. You built a beautiful home which is voice control, not even remote control. Subhanallah. You go into the kitchen and you say, water, boil. And the water starts boiling. Allahu Akbar. Have you seen it? It's there. I'm not joking with you. Sisters must be excited. No, don't give orders to me. I'm not a sales rep. Remember, we are doing that for our homes. What about, what have you done for your palace in the Akhirah? Have you spent money equivalent to that? No. Have you spent half of that? No. Your house was 8 million. Have you spent 4 million for your qabr? No, we haven't. We had to have 200 or 300 rands that we had to get food in return of for a dinner in order to force us to give a cause where the Muslims were drowning and they had to call for that. May Allah protect us. Where are the wealthy amongst us? I challenge those who are seated in front of me. From amongst you, is there nobody who can come up, stand up, go to the school and go to the cause and say, you know what? Everything is on me. Forget about everyone else. Allahu Akbar. Anyone? Wallahi, your Jannah will be there if you do it for the pleasure of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you can't do the whole thing, at least a small thing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Then there is a sign of Qiyamah today that I read that made me cry. You know, we've just completed Hajj. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, there will come a time and there will be no one going for Hajj. Nobody, nothing, no Hajj. Allahu Akbar. Whether it is for purposes of war or whatever other purpose it is, only Allah knows. La yuhajj bil bayt. There will be no Hajj to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine, sign of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has prophesied many other points. He speaks about how a person will not want to be an imam to the degree that you won't find an imam and a muadhin in the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People won't want to be the imam. What is the reason? Maybe because the trustees might be hard. Maybe because these people don't have qualifications. Maybe because of the sins of the people. Whatever it is, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the respect of the imams. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us respect of the muadhinin. There is a hadith which says there will come a time when the powerful people will eat up the weak people completely. You see it happening today. A man has a business. When another man wants to open a small business similar to that, he says, no, you must buy from me, otherwise I block you. He goes to the big supplier and he says, you see that small boy, if you supply him, I'm not going to buy from you. You don't supply him. So that small man who was making 1,000 rands a month is now blocked by the big man who is making 1,000,000 rands a month. Why? Because he's a big boss. So this is what the hadith says. The big will begin to devour the small. Do not be selfish when it comes to sustenance. Yours is going to get to you. You know what one narration says? Your wealth that you are going to use is written. So if you have, you will definitely get that. If you have more than that, it may go to some of your heirs. And if you have much more than that, it can only be used for fitna, unless you have piety. Allahu Akbar. So if you don't have piety and you got a lot of wealth, it will only be used for your children to fight each other and for that wealth to be a means of your destruction. The Quran says it. فَلَا تُعْجِبَكَ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَأَوْلَادُهُمْ. Do not let their children and their wealth amuse you and impress you. Allah says, we are going to use their children and their wealth to punish them in the dunya. May Allah not make us from amongst those. Then the Prophet ﷺ has also prophesied the vehicles that we are driving today. He says there will come a time when the conveyance will be so comfortable and it will be so cozy that it will come right to the door of the masjid and the person will leave it. It will be effortless, complete effortless. The words used in the hadith, today the ulama have clearly said, it describes this conveyance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us every form of goodness, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. I want to quickly move through 4 or 5 of the major signs of Qiyamah. And that inshallah will be a topic of discussion at some later stage inshallah. One of the first signs is Al-Mahdi, who is a religious person, a scholar, a pious person, who is from the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who will appear one day when the ummah is in great turmoil and turbulence, and he will appear in Mecca, and at the same time he will be helped and assisted, and that is the time when a little bit of authority will return to the ummah, and that is the time when some form of peace and stability will return to the ummah. We then have the issue of the Dajjal, the Antichrist, the one-eyed, and that he will appear after that. Thereafter you have the Prophet Jesus, may peace be upon him, who was taken up by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will return to the earth as a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thereafter you have Ya'juj and Ma'juj, nation of two people, or should I say two people, two little nations, two little groups of people, short people, who will be able to travel the earth within a flash. They will spread lots of vice and corruption and chaos on the earth. Then you have one of the last signs of Qiyamah is when the sun rises from the west. And when that happens, then there is no more Tawbah. And the Prophet ﷺ says, that will only happen when there is nobody on earth saying, Allah, Allah. Not one person will mention the name of Allah on earth. So people will either be Satanists or they will be everything else. But there will be nobody saying, Allah, Allah. Today, alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We speak about Him. We are here in order to listen to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the prophecies that He had given Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us goodness, to grant us a lesson. I have mentioned as much as I can. If you would like to go into the books, there is a very good English book that is well presented, written by Sheikh Muhammad Al-Arifi. It is called The End of Time, or The End of the World and the Signs. You will find it. It is available even in this country in some of the Islamic bookstores. That is a book where a lot of what I have said is made mention of. The Arabic of it has more than the English of it. So if you speak Arabic, that would be interesting. Then there are 2 Arabic books that I used as well in order to research for this evening, over and above what I've just mentioned. One is a book called Ashratu Sa'a, which means the signs of Qiyamah, written by Sheikh Yusuf ibn Abdullah al-Wahbil. And the other is also a book with the same title, Ashratu Sa'a, the signs of Qiyamah, written by Abdullah ibn Sulaiman al-Ghafiri. So these are the books. Whatever I have said, you will find it in there. I have not said anything that is not in those particular books. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us, to grant us goodness. Until we meet again, we say, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, subhanallah bihamdih, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la